Actually, ironically enough, I was also casting C West right before I went over to bother you. Was getting ICC Valkyries versus Regen Divine. Apparently, this is just like Regen Knight, because I'm now with Regen Ghost and Heavy Hitters. Stukov being banned out, and we do have Fight Time. Paystar going to come out with the Bright Wing, the Wing of Brightness. Lub here with the Smart Bet. Already yawning. This is a bad moment. We do have Mongoose coming out with Leoric, Mulby's favorite hero. And then Gilshmak on the Orphea. We do a lot of Garrosh. Tezo making a very, very, like, they're banning, like, we're banning tanks like crazy. There are three tanks not available. Let's go ahead and grab a tank now. This will probably let them also get a tank. Oh, and I do like Zul going into Leoric. Now here's the thing, if Mongoose actually tries to fight the Zul, Leoric stomps all over Zul. Zul's big claim to fame is being able to hold you in place and be and hit you with scythes, but of course Leoric laughs at that. We do have the Valala coming out of here. Does see that they've got their offlaner, their tank, and their healer. Actually, I have an Anduin ban. I'm surprised they don't just continue to like choke down on the tanks, but they don't. Gonna get Anduin right on out of here. Deciding that they've taken out all the tanks that they are afraid of.
We will forge a great destiny.
They're gonna come out and be like, you banned my son? I am here for vengeance. We do go ahead and have the Gray Mane coming out of Idai. So two more DPSers have to go. Will we have globals? Will there be Brawl? Will we have a Vikings? Probably not. I doubt I would see a Vikings after we already have Zul. Ape monkey come out, get Zarya. Ape monkey go to job. And then, oh my, what is this name? Xanthanarium? The Light Abandoned Snowman. Uther on the Andrew. Interesting. Very, very, very heavy blow-up comp. But they do have Zarya to protect them. Very, very interesting. Brett, we do go and have some reverse. Reversing back? I don't know. This is why I don't have the Poppins anymore, because teams keep doing this. And it makes me seem silly. But we are going to the game right now. I'll get you the intro movie, and I'll get you some wonderful, wonderful gambling. Put your money where your mouth is, and I will see you in just a second.
Leonidas drops the stun and drops the full ult. Oh my goodness, look at the health bars. It's a quad kill.
Should find the kill. Lunara will clean up that fight. Oh my god, I can't believe it. It is going to be Soul Shield. You gotta be kidding me.
Raw to take the 3v1, gets one, looking for the second. Crispy is popping off. Crispy.
Like that Blizzard may connect with four people.
Oh, Lady Ronin. Oh my goodness, what a chat.
That was really good.
Prepare yourself for battle. Heroes.
Perfect timing. That lasted just about as long as it needed to. We are in the game right now over here on the side of our blue team, our Cyan Centurions. We do go and have Gecko coming out on Zul. Xenarthium is going to be on Cassia. We do go and have K-Star on the Brightwing. Ape Monkey on the Zarya. And Tezo Paco is going to be playing the Garrosh. Loktosh Garrosh.
5, 4, 3, 2.
Hector? I just looked over and cracked up on the orange side of the battlefield. The oligarchy of Oblivion. We do go and have Eren on the Varian. Mongoose on Bone Boy. We do go and have Gilshmak on the Orphea. Idai is going to be on Greymane. And Andrew on the Uther. Gecko in here. Mongoose would go up top, but we do have, oh my goodness, I should have come down here sooner. I was watching the offlaners because they are cool and sexy and amazing, but we have a nice quick just bap as we do have Zarya and Garrosh go out of here. Bulby is likely feeling a little bit more secure than they did before. You know what? We're still early, early game. Here are some stabby stabs coming out. Ape Monkey clears this out. Everyone is back up. About half a level advantage so far. We do go and have both teams looking at their separate camps. Going to go and get those cleaned up. 1 second, let me adjust my voice very slightly. I think this sounds a bit better. Our moving over here, Tezopaco going to be aggressed upon. There is the throw. Varian goes in and gets caught. There is a little bit of damage to the shields. Aaron trying to get away. You are not a real boy yet, Aaron. This is why I don't play tank and don't play Varian. Because someone would eventually be like, you're not a real boy, Rocka. And I'd be like, fuck? What did you say to me? You could have Ape Monkey coming off. Big ol' magical hammer coming down from the Uther. Aaron goes ahead and gets some damage. Check it out. Offlaner's getting screen time. What you gonna do about it? Try harder. I'm so nice. So we do go ahead and have everyone kind of moving on out. Moving on out. Tezo in the middle of a lot of people. Does go and get shielded by the Zarya, but very, very, very low. Tezo needs to not be in here. This is Garage, so obviously we'll take less damage. But this was not the engagement they were really looking for. No one got thrown out of position. That's the problem. Like, who are you really looking for? Greymane and Orphea, I guess. But none of, both of those guys are a little bit resistant to being getting their hands put on them. Mongoose kind of... Oh, Mongoose? I wish I'd caught the beginning of that, but you know what? We do go and have a counter kill on the side of Heavy Hitters. Andrew goes in and goes down. A huge, huge, huge engage by Heavy Hitters. And we do have Uther going down as well. This is getting picked up. Is Gekko going to be able to interrupt this? The answer seems to be yes. Yep, Mongoose backs off. We might get a tripler. Oh, Gekko is running back here. Gonna try and get away, but here is Aaron. Aaron says, no, you're not going anywhere. And we do go and have Zul being taken out. Here are some shots from Ghost coming right on back, trying to make the core a distant memory. Oh, hello, hello, pass. Fair warning. This is when I do my esports casting, so there's a 30-second delay. I may not be as like involved in chat because, well, obviously, anything I say you'll see 30 seconds later. But right now, this is Towers of Doom. This is a little bit different than most maps in Heroes of the Storm. You can't directly assault the core. There's this big ol' no man's land with, look at these heckin' cannons. You can't walk into no man's land. You'll get blown up. So instead, you have to go ahead and try and channel these. We have Tezopaco takes a lot of damage. Big old aggression coming in here. And once again, now I gotta tell you, when Garage goes down, Zarya goes down right with him. There the sappers go running in. The third one actually landed absolutely nothing and blew up. That's always unfortunate. Definitely not a thing we're looking for. But it looks like Region Ghost is going to move in here, try and convert this bottom tower. They did go ahead and get both of the sapper camps. Here comes the blue team one more time, moving in here, saying, okay, you can take our wall, but you'll never take our fort. Or if you do take our fort, we'll take it back. The altars are coming up online. Four shots to whoever can channel these guys. We do have an advantage in core health up here. You will see 36 on the side of the blue team, 32 on the side of the orange team. There is the taunt. Taunt comes in and gets on Tezopaco, but we are potentially throwable. There's the unstoppable coming out. It does look like Gigglesmack will get that channeled. We have shots going across both ways. 28-32, still in favor of heavy hitters. I do love that voice line the most. I will not return to those wretched mines. And even the announcer of Haunted Mines hates that map. Oh, Gecko? Gecko, you walk too far? Thought that the other team had moved down below, so started running across, and then Varian just came out, did a big old taunt, said, you're not going anywhere? And he didn't go anywhere. Zarya moves up to the top of the map. Experience is very, very important. You will see these orbs start to move as soon as she gets up there. Oh, this one is apparently for the other team, and it's just going to fade away. Mongoose draining her hope says, get out of here, Hope. This is 2022. There's no hope allowed. So right now we are at level 10s. I have not pulled up talents yet. I'm terrible. We do have Entomb coming from Leoric. Going to restrict the opponent's ability to move around. Eternal Feast, Divine Shield, Cursed Bullet, and Warbringer. On the other side, we do have Decimate. Oh, interesting. There is Eternal Feast. You're not going anywhere. The little tentacles will come out. Tezopako getting down. A lot of people just got eaten. Eternal Feast will keep on hitting as long as there's someone within the area. And Entomb just does not let them leave, so a lot of free hits. However, there's a nice throw to Idai. Idai will go into Eternal Night.
The altars have risen. Activate them now.
Altars have come up. We'll be channeled by Mongoose right here. And we should have an evening out as four more shots come right across. 28-28 in terms of the poor health. Nice stone on Tezopako, but there is Brightwing coming in for the heal. Where they do go and get a throw into Andrew. There's the Decimate looking for the throw, looking for the throw. There it goes. Andrew goes back into the enemy team. Polymorph comes down and does use Divine Shield to become invulnerable. Will they be able to get out? Andrew very, very low. Does go and throw in Cassia forward. And yes, we have a kill into Uther. Uther Ghost is going to walk around for a little bit and be able to heal his allies because he is a residual spirit of holiness that only lasts for so long before he goes back to the grave. Or more correctly, back to the Nexus. We do have Gecko moving in here. We're going to try and come in here. There is a nice throw. Zarya comes in, but there's the Eternal Feast. Hey, if you're going to sit here, you're going to take a lot of damage from this nom 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 nom. But Idai takes a lot of damage as well. Tezopaka goes and gets that. Is running out, down to about 1,000 health. But this will be converted. This bottom fort is going down. And it's going to be remade in Blue's image. The Raven Lord, the Blue Commander, is going to come back. If you look at these, you will see that this has turned blue, indicating that if the blue team gets this, it will be 5 shots. If the yellow team gets it, it will only be 3. There is the throw, but once again, we have a nice trade for trade. Uther goes down, but so does the garage. It does look like Zul is the next one to go down. They are moving forward. Varian is still up. Cassia? This is not going to work out, girl. Okay, good. I'm like, don't go down there. Eagle Smackovers then channels this. They only do get 3 shots, as I said, dropping their opponent's score down to 25 health. They need to convert this back. Well, unfortunately, they couldn't convert it first. It looks like the Gravekeeper has taken another tower. There's the Dismate. Orphea gets thrown in. Orphea going to get absolutely killed. But we do go and have a nice Eternal Feast. Just a lot of damage coming in onto Gecko. But it does look like we're going to have a kill into Varian as well. That is a 2-for-0. 10 kills to 10 kills. Very even game. And we are charging forward to level 16 and another Talenteer. Is he converted right on back? Right on back. Bone Daddy goes and becomes unstoppable. Is not throwable when you can't stop him. Because once you E, the bones don't stop. And they are looking to convert another one and another one. Mongoose does get out, but another fort falls to the Raven Lord. Only one fort still remains under the Gravekeeper's control. This could be devastating. Every one of these is picked up will be six shots. There are 18 shots available right now.
You have done well, heroes. Let the grave know my power.
Enough of the charade.
There is Ape Monkey coming in. There's the Eternal Feast. A lot of damage comes through. Actually managed to get out. And there is the big old Poison Nova. Poison going in every direction. We have bouncing balls of lightning going through. Mongoose gets taken out. Very, very, very low health on E-Day. Meanwhile, up top, we do go ahead and have Varian trying to get out. Is down to 600 and will escape. Ide, you are so low, my friend. I wish you would step back from that little conference. This way Andrew will get this turned in, but unfortunately that's only two shots.
The Raven Lord will fall before.
Takes that down to 23 health. I like this from Mongoose. Mongoose moves up. It's like they're going to try and move in on this. I need to defend it. Converts one of them back. Getting to 3 versus 5 in terms of the shot totals. We have Aaron moving down. We're going to go ahead and try and turn this back around, but we do have a Sapper Camp starting to move across the map. Aaron moves up, says this is where they're going to be.
This leads to the battleground center. Use it well.
What? I mean,
all right, here we go right now. We do have, they are defending this. These sappers will do one damage if they can cross this deadline. Deadline, not like having a paper to turn in. Different kind of deadline. Oh, there's Ide getting thrown, and Big Ol' Invulnerable comes out in order to stop that. Oh, Greymane just goes crazy and eats the crap out of Zul, but there is a kill onto Greymane and then another one to Cassia. Looks like Varian may be the next one to go down. It is 2 for 2 so far. There is a lot of these sappers right at the edge. Mongoose gets polymorphed and will be taken out. Massive, massive go back and forth, but it is 3 versus 2. But they can't quite get those these guys over. However, here's a double turn in. This is potentially 10 shots. Because 5 plus 5 is 10. I can do math, you guys. Gotta tell you, this is amazing. Giggle Smack does move through into No Man's Land, and you can see the I don't know why I call it No Man's Land. This is obviously Orange's Land. The cannons don't care if orange heroes are here, but the second a blue hero shows up, cannons get super, super upset about it. All right, sorry about that. I had a, like, bad itch, and I was like, I have to scratch my head right now. You have level 20s picked up on the side of Heavy Hitters. Invisible Friends, Rock Stomper, and Dariel's Visage, Gravity Kills, and Titanic Knight. We're gonna move in and take this one. That does leave this area somewhat undefended, but no, they're gonna move north and try and defend this. There once again is the Eternal Feast. Ape Monkey having a hard time together. There is a taunt coming in, but once again, it's a one for one. They save this, but nope, no, they don't. Just kidding.
The tower now belongs to me.
Big ol', big ol'. There's a throw, double throw. Andrew and Ide looking very, very low. We do have Uther going down. Is going to be able to ghost heal a lot of people and does manage to get the rest of his team out. Some No Man's Bombard going on to his Zenitharium. They overcommitted just slightly. This is game over right here. K-Star going to go ahead and turn this in. We do have a garage going down, but you know what? We also have a core going down. Whoop. Not that far. All right. That is well taken care of. So, looking at the summary at the end of the match. Yep. This is Towers of Doom. Let me be more gothy. Looking at this, at the end of the match, we do go ahead and have... Healing-wise, K-Star going crazy, doing 70,000 healing. Uther only getting out 40,000. However... We do have to absolutely point out that Uther is not a hero you take for the raw healing numbers. Uther is a much more of a utility healer, so that's not surprising. Damage-wise, Giggle Schmack leading the way, but Cassio right there with them. About 74,000 apiece. Zul and Grimmie coming in next. In terms of that soak, Zul does outperform the Leoric significantly by about 3,000. And Yeah, the garage was nuts. So good play going in. Tezo just gets it done. Wow. Looking at talents, we've got some of those. I'm an offlaner by trade, so consume vitality does get more swings off. And then the paralyzing rage, fantastic. Interesting, took the rage there instead of the move speed. Not what I normally see. None of these guys are hyper-mobile, except for maybe the Brightwing with a blink. So that's a bit of an interesting pickup. Entomb. Really went for the Drain of Hope build, not something I normally see. And then we do have Buried Alive, obviously. Everyone else, we got them. Look at them, love them. And I will see you in game number 2. As always, please enjoy the theme song that Heavy Hitters did not pick because they never actually got back to me, so I'm actually reusing the one from the previous series. Whoopsie. All right, here we are in game number 2. They didn't even wait for me to confirm I was ready. How rude. But you know what? I am ready because I'm a Goram professional. We do go ahead and have Infernal Shrines. As you can see, this time around, we do go ahead and have first ban over the side of Region Ghost. Once again, they get rid of the Tyrael. I After that last game, I'm afraid of the garage. I don't know what you guys are talking about. Like, that garage was so, so well played. Excuse me, let me go and take my boots off. They're getting kind of tight for me. I don't like it. I'm still standing. I like that song a lot. I actually hadn't heard it previously. So we do have same bans as game number one. Nope, never mind, not anymore. We do go and have Zarya being banned out. So the question is, will we have a Hogger ban? Hogger is so good on this map. This is a map that really gives you a whole like breadth of strategies you can do. Did you take out? It just seems to me like they want to make sure that you have to move. No, still taking the Johanna out, not afraid of Regen Ghost. That may come out. Malby, you know how to make me show off my boots. You are not new here.
It's about time.
Now that is a weird first pick. Does that mean we have a Deathwing or a Diablo in our future? I mean, Tychus is just really good regardless, so don't get me wrong. Once again, like I said, so here's the thing, like, Garage doesn't really have to worry about a Tychus, because when you're within range of the minigun, you're almost in range of being thrown. We do have the K-Star on the Brightwing as well, Mongoose sticking around with Bone Daddy, and we do have Idei on the, so they actually front-loaded both of their damage. They still need their healer and their tank. The other side only needs their offlaner and both their DPS. There you go, Malby, good job, I'm proud of you. I'm still standing. I think I'm showing these a lot lately. But these are my snow boots. I'm wearing them a lot. Oh, you can't really see them. One second. Super blood red and black. I like them a lot. They're very, very stylish. Winter has come to Rochester, and so I'm wearing my boots a lot. However, do I see a Mephisto? Because I gotta tell you, I think I see a Mephisto. And we also have a Anubarak as well as a Rhaegar. So very, very, very heavy engage. Anubarak goes forward, gets the double stun. Tychus goes ham on someone, as well as Jaina getting the freeze combo. And Artanis in the offlane going up to Leoric. That's interesting. Like, Artanis will win if Mongoose actually sticks around and fights them. But if Mongoose double soaks or just avoids the fight, because you can kind of bait Artanis into taking a Protector of Ire and then not give that any value. Which should be the play. But we're going into the game right now. Don't go anywhere. I will go ahead and play out our amazing intro that someone that's clearly a genius put together. I'll see you guys in just a second.
Leonidas drops the stun and drops the full ult. Oh my goodness, look at the health bars. It's a quad kill.
He should find the kill. Lunara will clean up that fight. Oh my god, I can't believe it. It is going to be Soul Shield. You gotta be kidding me.
Raw to take the 3v1. Gets one. Looking for the second. Crispy is popping off.
Looks like that Blizzard may connect with four people.
Oh, Lady Ronin. Oh my goodness, what a chat.
That was really good.
Once again, right as we get into the game, fantastic. I love it. I love it. So we do go ahead and have, representing the Cyan team, we do have heavy hitters, the Hospitaliers of Heresy, Tezopaco is once again on the Terrifying Garage. Gecko is going to be on the Junkrat. K-Star on Brightwing. We do have Artanis being played by Ape Monkey. And then Zathanarium is going to be on the Mephisto. Meanwhile, on the orange side of the battlefield, representing Regen Ghost, the Generals of Genocide. We do got to have Mongoose playing the Leoric. Eren on the Anubarak. E-Day 15 is going to be on Jaina. Andrew on Mecha Rhaegar. And Giggle Schmack going to be on the Infested Tychus. Swap coming in, but of course this is the teleporter. Now we'll be going right back to that same spot in a second though. Eren takes a huge bit of damage, but so does Ape Monkey. Ape Monkey goes and goes back. K-Star goes back to heal them. Ah! Sorry, my cord got stuck. We do go ahead and have on the Artanis. Did take reactive parry, so it's going to try and beat it, but that means Mongoose doesn't have to be as careful about actually going for a, like, engage. Eren goes and gets the stun on Paco, and then it's like, wait, I don't want to be here. Never mind, I made a mistake. Looking at our level 1 talents, we do go ahead and have Unyielding Power. Currently 10% of the way done. On the other side, we do go down Figures of Frost coming through. Jaina, also about 10% done with her Frostbite quest. Frostbite baseline, I guess I should say. Nice invade coming in here with heavy hitters. Little Schmack is walking forward. Tezopaco needs to be a bit careful, is getting shredded by this Tycho, but Giggle Schmack also getting shredded in return. You go and take quarterback at level 1. That's exactly the problem, because if Tychus is going to be still and actually hitting Tezopaco, he really needs someone to be between him and Garrosh, or Garrosh will just step forward and do that. All right, Mongoose going back up above. Mongoose did take Consumed Vitality, which means he doesn't have any real healing outside of hitting a hero. When he's like this, it's harder for him to actually get the health back. Obviously, the other two, Orsian Renewal and... I forget the name of the other talent. We have level 5 all. Tychus... did take the bigger they are. I actually hate this decision. Because here's the reason I hate this decision. Bigger they are will get... Oh, good lord, Mongoose? Bigger they are is going to get Garrosh down to 30% very, very, very quickly. But then at 30%, when he has, 35 armor and takes way, way less damage, the ability you have to actually finish him off doesn't work anymore. Ape Monkey goes in and gets taken out, but so does the Anubarak. Zenitharium is going to go ahead and go through. Mongoose backs off. That ended up being a 2-for-1, I believe. All right, here's a lot of damage going through. Mongoose going ahead and draining soul. They are already up to only 8 left. If they're going to, they have to actually kill these guys off very, very quickly. We want to stop this up to 5 left. There is a failed swap. Then we're going to get that through. And it does look like K-Star going to go down. Brightwing goes down. Tezopaco going to be the next one going down. Only needs 2 more. 1 more. I don't think they're going to be able to stop this, but they can definitely make them pay for it. Frozen Punisher is out on the field. It does look like a monkey is being chased down. But the Punisher needs to be dealt with. We are 3-3, level 7 all. All right, we do go and have that being taken care of. Looking at the other side of the bottle field, we have Aaron sees the rotation coming in. I would not have engaged like that, Aaron. Like, you actually blew your escape in order to get a small stun. You could have, like, shot the lines out and gotten a whole bunch of them, but they do go in and get the garage down. Like, Zanarium is being chased down by Tychus. So still at the end, you got one for one. I just feel like using the spines to get a stun on all of them and then burrowing this way would have probably been a better solution. Still. That song stuck in my head. It's a problem. We do go and have a lot of damage going on to the shaman camp. They'll get the Katra picked up, but meanwhile, the bottom Katra is picked up by heavy hitters. They say that our opponents aren't in the area. Our opponents are busy trying to get their own camp. They can't contest this, so let's do it. But they engaged. I'm sorry for missing the first part of that. I think they went for a gank onto Artanis. Everyone else moved in to save, but they end up losing two people. And we are at the cusp of level 10s on the side of Region Ghost. Actually, everyone gets level 10s about the same time. Playing off that one ended up making the difference. We do get Suppression Pulse, Endurance of Hate, Link Heal, Decimate, and Riptire. On the other side of the bottle field, we do go and get Entomb, Ancestral Healing, Water Ellie, Cocoon, and... Tychus does not know. Tychus has that meme going on where he's like got the two buttons that he has to choose to press. This looks like it will be an arcane shrine coming up at the top of the map. The shaman camp is being picked up right now by heavy hitters. The Rosh is here in the middle. Don't step out too far, my friend. Alright, Tezopaka goes ahead and gets the throw on to Aaron. Polymorph comes down. There is a big ol' heal. Aaron does go ahead and web wraps the Artanis. We do have a kill onto Junkrat. Artanis is coming out, but there is the blind hitting the entire battlefield. We did end up getting the drill. Drill's going to be to focus on 8 Monkey. So far, the only actual kill is against the Junkrat. There is Mongoose. Mongoose gets thrown and Polymorph. There is a very, very low, but Tezopaka also extremely low. Does get a heal in from Brightwings. That's coming in. Very, very, very low health bars on the side of Regen Ghost. Aaron trying to screen for Giggleschmack, but not going to happen as Tezopaka comes inside. Decimate comes out and Tychus goes down. Aaron going to be thrown back into the wolves, or more correctly, the demons in this case. Demons and dragons, oh my. We will have an Arcane Punisher coming up in just a second. There is some attempt to get side pressure going on. Level 13 is online for heavy hitters. What will they do? How will they push into this? Aaron is in the area. Now, a Nuparok can avoid the jump, but has to be timed perfectly. Was not timed perfectly. We do you're going to have top four going down very, very, very swiftly. Leoric trying to work on bottom four, but is really just trying to keep them in game in terms of experience. The Punisher is down to about a half health as it marches on the keep wall. Alright, there is a cocoon coming down onto Mephisto. Mephisto can, of course, try and use the teleport. Did go ahead and use it, but there's Mongoose waiting for that to come back. There is the Ancestral that comes out, goes ahead and gets the healing back up, does throw Arcanus to safety, but Tezopaco is not going to get out of this, I don't believe. But you know what? Maybe shut my mouth? There's a big old shift onto Andrew. Andrew wanted to be a hero, does end up sacrificing himself trying to get Tezopaco, but the Artanis does in fact go down. We are just under a level ahead for heavy hitters. They're trying to move in right now. There is Mongoose getting thrown. Nine kills all? So that is the question. Oh, interesting. We get Spectral Leech on the Leoric this game. Obviously, I understand why, because this does cause your base attacks to do 2.5% of the hero's maximum health. That will really help them take out the garage, especially with the level 16 quest that I presume is coming. Poor noob just cannot press his E button. Yeah, indeed, we are at 2 stacks of the Mithril Mace. So this will be a mortar shrine coming in the middle of the map in just a moment. Chew it over with Twix. Both teams going for their shaman camp right quick. Now here's the problem, Mithril Mace will not get stacked in the shrine. Unless Leoric dips down to try and get it right quick. Nice unstoppable. I do think the Artanis was going for a swap there, but will not be successful. Good grief. I'm sorry for not really commenting. I was watching the Leoric. And then everybody died? Everybody died! Here's everyone else. We do have the Mortar Punisher coming out right now on the side of heavy hitters. Okay, not right now, but in 10. There's no way Tyke is going to contest this. Tyke's actually had to go up and deal with this shaman camp. Here's the Mortar Punisher going ahead and doing his little angy stomp. Going into the middle, but meanwhile it does delay heavy hitters to move into the area. Once another shaman camp. Said, hey, that first shaman camp got a lot of value. Let's go ahead and try and double it up. Leoric has returned. Everyone is back on the battlefield. Blue team has destroyed a fort. We've got the Punisher moving forward. Quite a bit of damage on the Aaron. Once again, they did go ahead and manage to cleanse that off. goodly bit of damage, but there are five members of the blue team pushing into this top heap. There is the polymorph, and we have Mongoose just getting obliterated. Currently up to 43 stacks of Mithril Mace. That's the problem. Even when you get the talent, Mongoose? Moves up to help the Shaman camp, looking for the second keep of the game. We do go and have Eren going through. There is the Draken Laser Drill coming down. A lot of damage and a lot of death onto the orc. Poor Garrosh is like, I've seen a lot of weapons, but I haven't seen a freaking, like, the power of the sun in drill form. Quite a bit of damage going through. Ape Monkey looking very, very, very low. We do have Mephisto things. There is Giggleshmack getting healed up, but Rhaegar is down, as is Mongoose turning it around. We do gonna have a big old swap and... Sorry, I said Mongoose, so I'm in a brack, and then the actual Mongoose died, and I'm like, well, now I'm a fool. That's probably the end of game number one and the series, as the level 20 heavy hitters start just marching down the top of the map. They're not going to let anything stop them, not least of all this stupid structure. Giggleshmack is like, well, I have a gun. Boom. Yeah, that's what I think of you. All right, Ape Monkey is going in, going to work. And we do go ahead and have the core goes down. Game number two and the series goes in favor of heavy hitters. Congratulations to them. Wait 1 second. I will see if I can't get ourselves a interview. In the meantime, Google these amazing talents. Alright, went ahead and got that taken care of. Now I can see if anyone joins me. I have to type and do a little bit more typing to make sure they didn't think this was required, because it definitely isn't. It's fine if people are just like, yeah, I'm tired. I'm definitely tired. It is 12:30 in the morning for me. Wow.
Hello.
Hello, hello. We are being joined by... I probably bunched up this entire cast. Xenatharium. Darn it, I was close.
Close enough, yeah.
So, first of all, congratulations. Kind of a gimme question to start us off, but how are you feeling?
Oh, I'm doing all right, thanks. A little bit high on adrenaline.
Definitely understand why. So, obviously this was your first match of the season, and I believe your first match with NGS?
No, I did play with NGS 2 seasons ago and 3 seasons ago, but it was with a different team, Deckard's Air Edition.
Oh, okay. I knew your captain. This is their first one, or at least they said it was, but maybe I misunderstood.
It is our team's first. I'm actually the only one who's been in NGS before.
Makes sense. Fantastic. So, fantastic play. Very, very, very heads up. First question. In both series, you guys just seemed absolutely bloodthirsty. Does your comp specifically because of what they try to run? Or do you just really, really enjoy comps that go in and make splatters happen? Because both teams kind of played the same way. It sort of felt like the teams run at each other and one of them ends up standing.
Yeah, I mean, to a certain extent, that's just HOTS. But no, I mean, that's really Tezo. Tezo is just always go in. That's his mentality 100% of the time. And we just do our best to, make sure it works.
So I did notice on Towers of Doom, the map played up fairly normally, but you guys started off, you got the bottom shrine, and then you got middle. It was interesting that It seemed like you guys, until the very, very end, only made a token effort of actually getting the sappers through. Most of your attention was seemed to be trying to push other shrines. Is that just what happened, or did I missee it?
Yeah, I mean, unless you're in an extremely advantageous position, which generally has to be in the late game, it's really just a risky strategy, as I see it, to push in pumpkins. So we kind of, I guess on Towers of Doom, we usually go for the safe plays because it's a map where one big risk isn't going to immediately win the game, you know, unless it's like one core health to one core health. So yeah, I just think we didn't really end up in a position where it seemed like the easiest thing to do to heighten our advantage was push them in. It was more often that we saw an opportunity where somebody was somewhere else that we could just push a tower and like, okay, here's an extra point of damage in our next altar phase. So
makes sense. It's just that was with having Garrosh on your team, I was almost sure that we'd see the throw the pumpkin over the line.
Yeah, maybe he should have tried for that. I don't know if any of us actually thought of that at the time, but yeah.
So the other part, which I thought was very, very interesting, in that draft, I'm pretty sure they picked Leoric, and then you guys still ended up picking the Zul. Now, granted, obviously, you're not the offlaner, but that was very curious because I always felt like Leoric kind of has an advantage into Zul. Though, admittedly, on that map, the offliners don't actually fight that often. Was there a specific reason, or are you like, yeah, I'm not the offlaner, I have no idea?
I mean, mostly, we leave a lot of autonomy to our members. Like, sometimes Tezza will say, hey, I want to do the Zarya thing, or I want to do the Tyrael thing, or whatever. Hence why they banned it twice. For the most part, we usually leave the final choice up to the people who are picking. So I think it's more that just Gecko, that's one of the double soakers he feels best on, for the most part.
Yeah, it makes sense. It's actually not a bad idea at all. Probably shouldn't be saying this, but I have definitely at times picked an early Leoric to try and bait out a Malthiel, just because Malthiel gets picked off in rotation so easily.
Mm-hmm.
So, grats on outplaying me, even though you weren't playing me.
Yeah.
Moving on to map number 2, obviously that's Infernal Shrines. This was the map that you got to come out with Mephisto, and you definitely managed to run around and get a lot of work done. So, first of all, well done. But secondly, what was it that made you want to use Mephisto specifically here? Because they didn't really seem to have that clumpy a team.
So it was kind of, I mean, for the most part, it's just because I love playing Mephisto. and I used to play him on a daily basis for like a year and a half. Exclusively. But in that game, it was mostly because they got Leo early in the draft, and I was just really annoyed by the Entombs in the first game. So I kind of didn't, you know, Mephisto generally just goes in with his shade, right? And then if Leo entombs you, then you just teleport back to your shade. If he entombs your shade, then he's probably too far up, unless you're playing badly. But, I mean, ultimately, I just wanted to play it. And Shrines is a good map for Mephisto. You, if you want to go with Spite, you have two minion waves always crashing right there next to every shrine. And, well, I guess except for the bottom one is kind of far. But, and then obviously any damage that you're doing on heroes, there's a fair amount. You get like two or three of the little skeleton guys as well. And Mephisto also likes maps where there's a lot of fights that happen at like, you know, when they're going to happen and where they're going to happen, and they happen in tight places. So I think he's always a good pick on shrines.
And then I kind of know the answer to this one already, but just in case, in map number 2, you guys were super, super, super on top of scouting, and you invaded into them taking camps on a very regular basis. Was there anything specific that made you want to do that? Or is it like, well, yeah, we were playing with Tezo, so we invaded?
we were playing with Tezo. Yeah.
That's kind of what I figured, but I was like, well, I can still ask. Last question. Where does the name Heavy Hitters come from?
Ask Tezo. It's just the name that he came up with. He was like, one day when we were all stacking in Storm League and playing, I mentioned NGS, and then a couple weeks later he said, you know, do you guys want to make an NGS team? And then a couple weeks later he just came up with the name Heavy Hitters. Maybe it's because he would consider Garrosh to be a heavy hitter, which I think you could say that. You know, he's got a chair, throws it at people. Well, not the chair, but he throws heroes.
He could throw a chair if he wanted to.
He could.
So, all right. So those are the questions I had for you. Let me turn it over to you for the shout-outs I'm sure you want to give.
Yeah, shout-out to all the people who are watching me at home. I don't know exactly how many of the texts I sent out ended up with people watching, but I think I know at least my mom's watching, so shout-out to my mom. Shout-out to the team, because I'll tell you what, there's a hell of a lot of less, or hell of a, that doesn't work. There's a lot less communication issues on this team than what I've experienced before. So it's just always a joy to play with this team, because we don't really tend to argue that much. Shout out to you for casting and all the NGS peeps who make this tournament happen. I think it's fantastic that HOTS has such a thriving community.
Thank you very much. We do our best. I got a double shout out there. For anyone watching that doesn't know, not only am I the caster, but I'm also the div mod for this team.
Yeah, I noticed that.
But I won't keep you from the after party anymore. So thank you very much. Fantastic play, and look forward to seeing you guys in the future.
Of course. Thank you. See ya.
It does look like there aren't any other NGS matches going on, so we're going to go over and bother Kairu.